Mira and Harper Audio present One Last Secret by Adele Parks, performed by Kristin Atherton. Chapter 1. No little girl grows up dreaming of becoming an escort, a sex worker, a whore. Keep that in mind. It's a job, right? A lot of people do difficult work, and many don't like their jobs. That's a fact about being an adult. We suck it up for a myriad of reasons. Maybe because we can't think of anything else to do. Or we don't believe there is anything else we could do, as we don't have qualifications or opportunities, or simply the energy to draft a new CV. We do, however, have rent or mortgages to pay, electricity, gas, and the lure of the local pub that sells a really average Chardonnay. So, we need to make money. From time to time, miners, couriers, sous chefs, debt collectors, refuge collectors, HGV drivers, labourers on building sites, care workers, list not finite, must all complain about the way they earn money. And they are entitled to. All those roles incorporate high-pressure deadlines and have low income growth potential. I'm just saying, none of us lives in Disneyland. Okay, PR girls, the ones in marketing and events management, you might very well be all wide-eyed and incredulous at this moment. You might be insisting, "But I love my job." Good for you. You will also be thinking, it is not paid well enough. You will be planning on marrying someone rich, if money matters to you, or living in rented accommodation all your life, if it doesn't. If you are thinking of marrying someone rich to supplement your lifestyle, to allow you to continue to pursue your dream job, then you need to pause on that thought before judging me. Look, don't take offence. I'm not saying you are like me, exactly. I'm just saying maybe we're not a million miles apart. Telling it as it is a core skill of mine. If I ever had to write a CV, I'd include it. Being rich doesn't really matter to me. That might surprise you. Being valued does. And that might surprise you more. Because people assume women who are prepared to accept money for sex have self-esteem issues. Side note, being rich, obscenely so, matters to many, many of the people I am surrounded by. So I know money is power, and I play the game. I know what money can and does buy. Anything. Everything. When we get to know one another a little more, I will elaborate on all of that. Let you in. Maybe even tell you how I started out. But not yet. I don't think the best relationships begin with retrospection. It's indulgent. I'm all about the moment we're in. I nod to a future when I dare. Looking back isn't my thing. I think most sex workers would agree with me. And that issue I mentioned, that no little girl grows up wanting to be an escort, well, that's true. But we, had dreams. Plans. I know I did. Today is perfect. The sun is shining just enough. The job I've just finished was perfectly fine. Fine. He didn't want to insult me, humiliate me, urinate on me. He didn't smell. I have a good nose. Well, I say good. In fact, it's a mixed blessing in my line of work. I probably should retrain as a perfumer or something. You can imagine the drawbacks of having that heightened sense in my job. The smell of a good cologne is usually guaranteed, thankfully. Men who can afford me can afford decent aftershave. But other smells come into it. His balls, neck, feet, crack. There are a lot of ways a man can become unappealing. I've learnt to breathe through my mouth. I just have to deal with it. If they do smell very badly, sometimes I suggest we shower together. Take a bath. It is what it is. But today I wasn't presented with any of those issues. I actually quite like him. Or I could, if I met him somewhere else. If I was someone else. Both things are impossible. I mean, where else might we meet? It's not like I'd ever turn up at his local neighbourhood watch or the monthly executive board meeting at his enormous blue-chip company, or any of the annual charitable trust meetings that he patrons, chairs, or fundraises for. Cancer, modern slavery, national ballet are his causes. These are the places he hangs out when he's not with me. Being respectable. Being brilliant and philanthropic. With me, he's filthier. I've been looking after him for about 5 months, and we get together every couple of weeks in a small boutique hotel in Richmond. I assume he must live or work nearby. He hasn't said, and I never probe. Clients find it unnerving. I prefer hotels over private homes. My regulars are always easier jobs. I guess I enjoy them the most. Or, more accurately, I fear and dislike them the least. I know what I'm walking into. I can gauge their moods, their needs. It doesn't absolutely remove the risk, because people are unpredictable, but it certainly reduces it. Today we had sex in an efficient, satisfactory way. The way a couple who have been together a decent period of time and know their way around one another's bodies might. After the sex, he still had 38 minutes on the clock. He'd paid up front for 2 45-minute sessions. As he's a regular, I might have allowed him to carry over the second session, but he didn't want to. He wanted to talk. Some of them are talkers. They think they want sex, but in fact, they want company. So they pay for sex, hoping that when it's all over, they can have a chat. With those clients, I see my role as something similar to that of a therapist. Therapists will hate that analogy. They will be rushing to post outraged, although carefully phrased, passive-aggressive tweets, refuting any parallel. They'll be frustrated to discover I don't have any social media accounts, so they can't cancel me. I'm not trying to offend therapists. I apologise if I have. I do appreciate that very few people like their profession being put on a par with mine. I'm simply saying that if I look hard enough, I can find the similarities. And I have looked. But it's just my opinion. You don't have to get worked up. Both my clients and the clients who lie on a therapist's couch undergo a stripping back. They are laid bare, either physically or mentally. Is it so different? Frankly, I think it's easier to take your clothes off than allow access to your deepest and darkest thoughts. Take my deepest and darkest orifices over that anytime. Sorry. I crack jokes when I'm nervous. I realise that I can come across as inappropriate. I guess I am the epitome of inappropriate. It's a professional hazard. I did briefly consider being a therapist, but I figured it would be exhausting. All those feelings. All that feeling. Obviously, I don't really do a lot of feeling in my line of work. It's a golden rule of survival. Anyway, all he wanted to do was talk. My client, Daniel, is almost 40. He is unmarried. He tells me most of his friends assume he's gay. I don't get that vibe. Paying for heterosexual sex must be pretty low down on a gay man's list of prioritizations, even if he were still in the closet. It's quite obvious that he is in love with his best friend's wife. He talks about her all the time. When I mooted the idea, he looked horrified. Maybe horrified that I'd found him so transparent, maybe horrified because it was the first time the thought had occurred to him. I don't know. However, in the moment the thought did occur to him, he must have known his love was doomed. Cece, the object of his adoration and idolization, doesn't know he is in love with her, because he's a shy, nice guy who has never dared make his feelings known. Not in the time before she married his bestie, and certainly not since. He has placed her firmly on a high-up, out-of-reach pedestal. And no other real woman can come close. The majority of his relationships have not stumbled past the 3 months anniversary. He tells me that the women he's dated are too ambitious, not ambitious enough, self-centered, overly clingy, boring, exhausting, and so on and so on. It's a shame. Daniel, I admit, is no looker. He has a face only a mother could love, but he is decent, clever, and very wealthy. I think he could be the answer to many women's needs, if not dreams. He has told me that he's stopped investing emotionally in relationships now. He's happy paying me twice a month to have the sort of sex a girlfriend might tire of, and then to chat about Cece, something I think even the most understanding girlfriend would find irritating. He is one of my favourite clients. I feel so comfortable with him that I shower before I leave. I dress in the bathroom so he doesn't see that I've shoved my lacy knickers in my handbag and have put on a pair of sensible cotton briefs. I wear my heels until I'm outside, back on the street, and then swap into trainers. I have to maintain standards, no matter how easygoing the client is. It's a warm, late May day. I sniff the air and can almost smell summer. I love spring. Not in its own right, but because it's the predecessor to summer, my actual favourite season. I have learnt that anticipation is genuinely a gift. Hot days slow my blood and heal my bones. They take me back to being young. Younger. I'm 31, so some people, like the wives, would think I am young now. But others, the daughters, would think I am old. My clients don't know I'm 31. I am whatever they want me to be within a range of 18 to 26. My manager, Elspeth, and I never speak of the age issue. I earn enough to indulge in all the high-end beauty treatments I want. I use filler and Botox to build up collagen and tighten jowls, lasers to vanquish spots and redness, fat-dissolving acids to lose the extra bit under my chin, and radiofrequency treatment for my neck. This, combined with a strict diet and lots of sleep, means I look like the angel I most certainly am not. I am young, old, ageless. It depends on your viewpoint. I am all things. Sometimes it feels like I'm nothing at all. And yes, I have a manager. You might think of her as my madam or my pimp, if you are the sort of person who thinks of your PA as a secretary. I text her to let her know I've exited the job safely. Even though he is a regular client, we always follow procedure. She texts me back, instructing me to drink lots of water and reiterating the importance of keeping hydrated for beautiful skin. after most jobs, she gifts me a little beauty tip. I think it's her way of showing she cares. Texts swapped, we can both let out a sigh of relief.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.